Hello and welcome to the COVID-19 weekly update. I'm Kerri Schuette, the Public Information Officer for the Shasta County Health and Human Services Agency. With us today, we have Dr. Karen Ramstrom. She's the Shasta County Health Officer. Judy Flores is the Shasta County Superintendent of Schools. Our healthcare providers include Robert Folden from Mercy Medical Center, Reading, Brandon Thornock from Shasta Community Health Center, Mark Mitchelson from Shasta Regional Medical Center, and Glenn Hayward from Reading Rancheria. Thank you all for being here with us today. We will start with the numbers, and today we're going to be reporting 183 new cases for a total of 844 active cases. We have 83 people in the hospital, including 17 who are in the intensive care unit. We are also going to, unfortunately, be reporting 3 new deaths today. We have a woman in her 60s, a man in his 70s, and a woman in her 80s. Robin Shurig, our public health director, is on jury duty today, so we're just going to go straight to Dr. Ramstrom for comments from Shasta County Public Health.
Good morning, everybody. So I thought I would share a little bit of data in addition to what Kerri shared, since Robin's not with us today. The CDC's 7-day case rate for the most recent 7-day period in Shasta County is 615 cases per 100,000, and that's down from 785 last week. Anything above 100 again is considered high transmission. You know, we're holding our breath to see if this is the beginning of a turnaround in our case rates, so stay tuned. I think it's a little bit too early to be certain of that. Maybe next week we'll have some good news. Our low vaccination rates, however, and low uptake of personal prevention measures in our community, in combination with the highly infectious Delta variant, will influence how quickly our case rates ultimately decline. Our vaccination rate is inching up very slowly, with the latest data showing 47.7% of Shasta County residents age 12 and older fully vaccinated. That's up 1 percentage point from last week, and 57.3% with at least one dose. This is still very low compared to the state vaccine coverage at 70.5% fully vaccinated. For hospitalizations, we heard from Kerri already, 83 people are in the hospital right now, 17 in the ICU. And sadly, we reported 13 deaths in the last week, and we extend our sympathies to the loved ones and colleagues of those individuals. As we've reported previously, the vast majority of our cases, hospitalizations, and deaths have been in unvaccinated individuals. We've had a total of 4 deaths among fully vaccinated individuals. All of these have been older adults who are vaccinated very early in the year, which reinforces the recent recommendation for booster doses among individuals 65 and older, which is a good transition to that topic. So last Friday, September 17th, the Vaccine and Related Biologic Products Advisory Committee of the FDA met about the Pfizer BioNTech requests for approval for booster doses. The committee voted to recommend the FDA authorize under EUA a booster dose of Pfizer at least 6 months after the primary series for people 65 and older and people at risk of severe COVID-19. They didn't formally vote on this, but they did talk about others who are at high risk, occupational risk, and we're expected to learn more about that. The Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices is meeting today and tomorrow, and they will talk about those kinds of details on how to implement the FDA's decision, including those potential high-risk occupational groups, which will likely include healthcare workers. We also heard this week, in terms of vaccines for children age 5 to 11, Pfizer announced promising results from their trials studying the effectiveness and safety of their COVID-19 vaccine for children age 5 to 11. The trial used a smaller vaccine dosage, 10 micrograms, rather than the 30 microgram dose that's used for people who are 12 and older. That dose was selected as the preferred dose for safety and effectiveness in young children. Pfizer is expected to submit their data anytime now to the Food and Drug Administration for review and possible emergency use authorization for children age 5 to 11. And then lastly, I just wanted to talk a little bit about a question that I've been getting frequently recently. Why get vaccinated if I can still get COVID-19? And there are multiple reasons. We know that no vaccine is 100% effective, not just COVID-19 vaccines, but all vaccines. So some breakthrough cases are expected, but most breakthrough cases are mild. And studies, including during the Delta surge, continue to show that the COVID-19 vaccines are working as they should, as they're intended to prevent severe illness, hospitalizations, and deaths. And this is reflected in California data. For the week of August 19th to September 4th, case rates were 8 times higher among unvaccinated Californians, and hospitalizations 10 times higher and deaths 15 times higher among unvaccinated individuals in California. In addition, there's growing evidence that vaccinated people are causing a very small amount of COVID-19 transmission. I think this is really important to know. Some of the earliest data on this came from Israel, showing that as few as 13% of vaccinated people with a breakthrough infection are spreading the virus. And this is supported by more recent research in the Netherlands and Singapore that shows that infectious virus shedding is less in quantity and for a shorter period of time among vaccinated individuals compared to unvaccinated people. And then very recently, just last week, a study came out indicating that the risk of long COVID is much lower, much less likely among vaccinated individuals. It's about half the risk. So in summary, as we always say, prevention is the way to go. It lowers the risk to the individual and the risk to others that we come in contact with, even often unknowingly. Our hospitals and healthcare workers are stretched, to say the least. And we'll hear, from them today, but not only in staffing, but in available beds and supplies. So we ask that everyone please do your part. Our community's resilience and recovery depends on all of us. If you haven't already, take steps to get vaccinated now. If you're not vaccinated, please layer on prevention measures. We need everyone to be part of the solution, not the alternative. And that's all I had today. Thanks.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Ramstrom. Judy Flores, can we check in with you next?
You bet. Well, good morning, everyone. Shasta County Public Health reported yesterday that students and staff from 52 K-12 schools and one office have reported a total of 227 cases in the last 14 days. So between the ages of 5 and 13, there were 91 cases in the last 14 days, which is double the previous week's average of 46. Those ages 14 to 18, there were 90, which is almost double last week's 14-day average of 54. And for staff, it was at 46, which last week's 14-day average was 59. The greatest number of reported positive cases over that 14-day average, the last 14-day average, is coming from 13 school sites. But probably the most important information, at least that really struck me in looking at the data, is since August 1 of this year, there have been 781 K-12 school-related COVID cases compared to 1,487 for all of last year for those ages 5 to 18 and school staff. So right now, in less than six full weeks of school, we are beyond 50% of the cases we had in all of last school year. So as you know, I asked yesterday for our schools and districts to share with me point in time data for yesterday, September 21st. There were 462 students in modified quarantine, which is an increase of 82 over the prior week. There were 914 students in quarantine at home, which is a decrease from the prior week, but still a lot of kids on quarantine at home. 219 students were experiencing a positive case yesterday. 95 school staff were at home on quarantine, and 51 school staff were experiencing a positive case. In terms of school closures, neither of the schools I'm going to share are truly closed. They are supporting students through independent study. Montgomery Creek School, it has transitioned to independent study for this week, and Black Butte schools have transitioned to independent study through September 28th. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Judy. So go over to our healthcare partners. Let's start with Robert Folden, followed by Mark.
Good morning. I don't think I have much new information to talk about today, other than, again, I just want to extend gratitude to our staff and physicians, because we're in a protracted kind of peak here right now, and caseload has dropped just a little. But if we compared the last two events that we had since COVID started, you know, it kind of suggests that we're about in the middle of this current wave, and it will likely go up again. So we're continuing to encourage vaccination. Obviously, mask wearing is important. We're in the process of kind of finalizing a survey process with our own staff to understand where folks are from a vaccination standpoint, or whether they're requesting a medical or a religious exemption. And I'll just acknowledge that process has taken far longer, I think, than anyone ever expected. And one of the challenges of being a national company is, you know, nationally there's a sort of a due date of November 1, but for those of us that are here in California, we've got this due date of October 1 or September 30. So as you can imagine, that's added some additional tension here in the workplace that's tough to manage. And again, I'm grateful for people's patience. And I just ask that staff continue to work with us. We know that come October 1, there will be a discernment period where we go through and assess where people are. But at the end of the day, we just want to keep providing the ministry here in the community. So I'll pause there. I guess the only other comment would be, we continue to restrict many of our, I'm going to call them non-emergent cases. I'm not going to call them elective surgical cases, but we do a lot of surgical volume here at Mercy Reading, and that is significantly curtailed. So for people who are in the community that need to have a non-emergent case, I think you're probably finding that to be very frustrating, where you think you have a case scheduled, but what it feels like at the last minute, those cases are canceled. And the reality is, on a day-to-day basis, late in the afternoon, we have to make an assessment of where our hospital is. And we've got several key medical staff members that are looking at, you know, where our census is today, what the cases are being performed tomorrow, and whether they're going to need, you know, certain resources, an ICU bed, a telemetry bed, or whatever the case may be, because we want to have a high level of confidence that we can support that. On those days where our census is already high and we know that those resources are tasked, we are declining to do cases that aren't the most emergent. And it's kind of frustrating to be in that scenario for everyone involved. I've got surgeons that want to work. I've got staff that want to work. We have patients that need to have procedures, but we're just at a point in time where we have to be careful and thoughtful about the cases we're doing. And I'll pause there.
All right, thanks, Robert. Let's check in with Mark, followed by Brandon.
All right, good morning, guys. So for us, similar, not much different than last week. We're still chugging along, super busy. Just, you know, thankful for everybody who comes into work. They're doing an amazing job. I think really one of the biggest things we've seen over this last week is an uptick in people wanting to come to the ER just to get tested, or, you know, I feel a little off and I want to get checked out. You know, that is not the appropriate setting for individuals that come to the ER for. If you want to just get tested, there's other options in the community. I know those options are stretched as well, but, you know, the ER is definitely not an appropriate place just because you feel a little off and you want to get tested. So, you know, just want to encourage the community to find other options at that point. But, you know, we're still here. If you're sick, you have an emergency, we're here. But, you know, just want to take it day by day.
Thank you, Mark, for that reminder. And on Shasta Ready, if you click on Get Tested, there are many, many, many options for testing. So thank you for that great reminder to not burden our emergency rooms with that. All right,
Brandon. Kerri, I'll add in there that Lab 24 is opening up a specimen collection site at the at basically the base of our hill. So at Rosalind and kind of Court Street. So they'll be operating, I think, the middle part of the day, Monday through Friday. So take a look at lab 24. Again, if you just need testing, that will be a drive-through specimen collection site. The testing will be done elsewhere, but at least folks can get testing done in a prompt manner.
Great, that's great to know. Thank you. And we have expanded our capacity at the Benton site as well. So hopefully that's alleviating some of the pressure on the testing system. All right, Brandon, you're up, followed by Glenn.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. So I'd like to share this week just to advocate a little bit for telephonic or televideo type appointments as you're reaching out to your primary care providers and other clinicians. I took a look at our numbers, and we have increased up to about 17% of our total visits are telephonic or televideo. We fully recognize that not everyone can do this type of visit. Some people just need to physically be seen, but by advocating for that or requesting that as you're calling in, that does reduce the potential exposure to those who may be more vulnerable and can't have that type of a visit. So that's one thing that can be done as it relates to getting your own health care and decreasing risk. Another thing I wanted to mention, when the initial mandate came out that all healthcare workers needed to be vaccinated or get one of those exemption requests, we saw a number of folks who were really frustrated and just up and left their employment here with us. And it's been actually really quite interesting and honestly refreshing to see. We've had a handful of folks who have come back and have requested to get their jobs back. And they have reported that, you know, they're willing to get the vaccine and they want to come back. And I'll just tell you, we are welcoming those folks with open arms. You know, we didn't want them to leave in the first place. These are great, great employees, great people. And, you know, they were just on the fence, and for whatever reason they made that decision, but they're coming back and we're bringing them back. And so I just, you know, I want to give a shout out to all those of you who may be out there and you're on the fence, you know, please roll up your sleeve, get your shot. We've had a number of 40-year-olds in this community who have passed away. I read an article yesterday that somebody in their 20s in Butte County has now passed away. Those are senseless deaths, and they did not need to happen. And I'm sure they're leaving young families behind, young kids. Doesn't need to happen. So if you're on the fence, join us who have already taken the plunge and gotten the shot, and let's get vaccinated. That is by far, the evidence has shown over and over and over again, that is the most successful way to combat this and to protect one another.
All right. Thank you very much, Brandon. Glenn, do you have an update for us today?
Thank you, Kerri. Can you hear me? Okay, great. We're happy that we got our numbers in today, and we're sitting at 82% of our health center staff are now fully vaccinated. We've been working hard to get everybody. We're down to 34 employees that have not been vaccinated yet. You know, we heard the rumors going through the mill when the mandate was coming through, and we had lots of extra people apply when we had open jobs because they thought, well, the tribe is not going to comply with the state mandate. Well, our tribal council takes our patient safety very seriously. And of this week, they adopted a mandate that is probably stricter than the state mandate. And so we have a lot of guidelines that we put in from our tribal council that will make it virtually impossible to get an exemption. So to be employed with us, you will have to be fully vaccinated. So we suspect that number will go down even more. And so we are hoping to be at 95 to 98% by October 15th. That's when ours goes into effect. So I reiterate what everybody has been saying. Our urgent care is very busy. We've added an extra provider on Saturday and Sunday just to deal with the testing and the treatment of COVID-like symptom patients. So it's still a little hairy out there.
All right. Thank you, Glenn. Thank you to our media partners for your patience. We had a lot of little lengthier than usual, but I think some really, really important updates today. And we are now ready for your questions.
Hi. Hi, everyone. This is Daisy with Channel 7. Maybe this is a question for Judy. Hey, Judy, I'm wondering how many Shasta County schools have been forced to close and or maybe move to distance learning for a period of time due to COVID outbreaks. I know you talked briefly about two schools, but I don't know if you know, generally speaking, how many.
Yeah, we've only had three fully close all grade levels, right? So we've had examples where a grade level or a classroom needed to move to an independent study model for that window of quarantine. But we've only had three schools. Castle Rock was the first, and now these two schools are the only ones that have had to move their full school to a independent study model.
Great, thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Good morning, everyone. This is Anna here from Action News Now. I just wanted to ask a little bit for you, Dr. Ramstrom. You know, we've said in the past, Shasta County has one of the lowest vax rates in the state. Are we still at that position right now? I know Tehama County, I believe, surpassed us in that.
Oh, we could look that up for you. I don't have that off the top of my head, but we're happy to get back to you with that, where we rank.
Thank you. And then just to follow up, also for, you mentioned that you touched on a little bit on the Pfizer vaccine booster dose. I know you mentioned before that it's something that's already in place for like more immunocompromised groups. Can you just elaborate a little bit on that again? Just I want a little more clarity.
Sure. So it's been, a month or so, maybe longer, I've lost track of time, that the additional dose for immunocompromised individuals, the mRNA vaccines are available for those individuals to have a third dose. And the FDA met on Friday, the advisory committee, and recommended consideration of a Pfizer booster for certain groups. So these are people who would have waning immunity. And so the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices is meeting today and tomorrow, and they'll make a final decision about that. And we should have more information in the next couple of days about what that's going to look like. The FDA, initially, they were voting on whether to make that available to all individuals 12 and up. And the group on Friday decided to narrow that down based on the available data where it looks like there's a need for a booster, and they limited it to 65 and older and individuals who are at high risk. So we'll see what the ACIP comes out with today and tomorrow.
Thank you, Dr. Ramstrom. And then another question too. You know, we talked about it. We talked on a little bit too for the 5 to 11-year-old group. I know it's still in the process, still in the trial phase at this time, but can we see that being implemented here in our area in Shasta County once, if it's approved, if and when?
Right. So we follow, you know, so there's a regulatory process as these different groups, age groups and what have you, are added. That goes through the FDA and the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices. And then once that is finalized, then we in public health and the other vaccine providers follow that guidance. And so we don't implement that until it goes through that whole regulatory, all those steps. And then we'll be able to implement it at that time. And so so the Pfizer still needs to submit their data to the FDA, and then they'll do their thing. And so probably not before October 15th or so, before 5 to 11-year-olds will be approved.
Thank you. And then I'm going to switch gears now to our hospital representatives. You guys talked a little bit. This one's for all of you, I guess specifically more for Robert and Mark. At this time, you know, how have things been handling? I mean, we've been seeing more cases in our area, in our community. Are the hospitals feeling like they're being overloaded? Is capacity still there? Just wanting to know what the status of that is like.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's no secret. We're very, very busy. It's probably the busiest we've been throughout all the different peaks for the last couple of weeks. I mean, capacity is still technically there. We just have been creative in how we've managed capacity, and we've got many different plans and ability to ebb and flow based on volumes. But you know, we still have capacity, but we just have to be careful and not getting to a certain point that we don't. I mean, we have a little bit to ebb and flow still.
And I'll just say every day is a challenge, right? If it weren't for staff that are routinely signing up for additional shifts or additional hours or willing to work outside of their normal work area, we'd be struggling even more. But the hospitals are full. So it's not uncommon on any given day to get calls from elsewhere throughout the state, you know, with other hospitals who are trying to see if we have capacity as well.
Thank you. And I'm just going through my list of questions here that I wrote out. And this one's for you, Robert. You mentioned, you know, you've had to put off some non-emergent cases because of, you know, what's happening at this time. Can we see a backlog of those non-emergent cases piling up in the future? I know, like you mentioned, people, you know, are kind of feeling frustrated that things do get canceled.
Yeah, so I'll give you a classic example. The person that needs their knee replaced, right? There's many different gradations of where a patient might be with their knee replacement. People who have an infection, or maybe their knee is so bad now that it's limiting their daily activities. Those are folks that we're going to try and get those cases in. But we're going to have a backlog just like we did during the last two waves that we saw. And what we do is we work with the physicians and we try and get those cases in as soon as the volume sort of subsides. So if I'm not mistaken, you know, the last wave we saw in the fall of last year, we did a lot of those cases, you know, extra cases on any given day. We opened up cases for Saturday and even a few cases on Sunday to try and get folks the procedures they need.
Anna, I wanted to ask if we could, you've had the opportunity to ask quite a few questions. I wanted to see if any of our other reporters might have questions, and then if we have time at the end, we can go back to the rest of your list, if that's okay.
Yeah, no problem. Go ahead. Anyone who feels free to jump in.
Are there other reporters who have questions?
Hi, my name is Netta with the Record Searchlight. I have a question for the Superintendent of Schools, Judy. So we know that there is a October 15th deadline for teachers to get vaccinated and for clinics to be set up, testing clinics to be set up at the schools. Do you have a percentage right now of how many teachers in the county are vaccinated? And have you heard any pushback from teachers as well about this, you know, decision, this request, requirement rather, to get vaccinated or test weekly?
So in terms of the timeline, you are correct. They have until October 15th to get a weekly testing system in place. In terms of actual numbers by district, we've not collected that from a county office perspective yet. We'll probably do so when we get closer to October 15th to just get a better sense of those numbers. We're not required to gather that information, but we've talked about doing that just to be able to provide that information to the media. It's been a question that's been ongoing. But in terms of pushback, you know, I think you'd have to check in with each one of the districts. I've not had anyone reach out to me coming from schools and districts in terms of that requirement, because it really is beyond what school districts and schools have the ability to influence. We're following what's been the order that's been directed.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Other media questions? Okay, Anna, if you have anything else, it sounds like we are ready for you.
Awesome, thank you so much. And anyone else, like I said, who wants to jump in anytime, go ahead, feel free. This one's kind of going back to, you know, we talked about the staffing. I know Brandon touched on it, and this one's all for our clinics and hospitals who are on this call. Are you guys seeing, you know, with that deadline coming up for staff to get vaccinated, are you guys still seeing resistance, like hesitation from your staff? And is that creating some staffing issues for your facilities?
So, Anna, the short answer is yes. We are still seeing some hesitation out there. And if folks do decide to leave healthcare, that could dramatically impact us as it relates to being able to provide services. That said, over time, as we're getting closer and closer to this looming deadline, I am seeing, and we are seeing, more and more people making a decision to get vaccinated or submit an exemption request for those who qualify. So we won't really know exactly what it's going to look like until we get to the date, unfortunately. I think a lot of people are waiting until the bitter end, but it is refreshing to see that some people are making a decision to get vaccinated.
Yeah, and I'll just echo. You know, we've been talking about choices, and you know, I've kind of said for the last 2 months that people have four choices to make. They can get vaccinated, they can file a medical exemption, they can file a religious exemption, or maybe they need to consider a different line of work. Because the reality is, this is probably bigger than just the state of California at this point, or any one of our companies. I'm pleased. I was not able to answer a question a couple weeks ago about what our current vaccination rate, and it looks like we're in the about 62 to 64% of our staff is vaccinated. And we know that there are many people that are, again, awaiting the word on their medical or religious exemptions. So we always want to be confident that come October 1, that we'll be fully staffed. And we're going to continue to work with people where we can. And somebody already made the comment. I mean, we've got a mission to provide here in the North State, and I can't do it without employees. So.
Any other questions?
Hi, Kerri. Hi. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Hey, this is Annalise with Shasta Scout. My question is about testing. Can you talk, I'm not sure if this is best for Dr. Ramstrom or Kerri Schuette, but can you talk about the average timeline in Shasta County for both how long it's taking individuals to access testing when they want it after symptoms or contacts, and their average timeline for receiving results, and then how that compares to maybe California's testing across the state, the length of testing?
You know, we're not going to have access to that across the whole system. I can tell you that we've heard pretty good turnaround for the state lab LHI site at the Boggs building. Those are run at the Valencia State Lab. And so I think that they tell you it can take up to 4 days, but we hear from people a day and a half to 2 days. We know that with these additional, with the increase in cases, increases in symptomatic people, increases in testing needs for schools and these other requirements, that there has been a lot of testing capacity need over the last couple months. And so there have been a variety of things that have been put in place to try and meet that need. And I think it's improved. I don't think it's perfect. We doubled the testing capacity at the Boggs about 2 or 3 weeks ago. There are several state programs that make a rapid testing available, including to CBOs, schools, et cetera. But I think that there's still room for improvement. But I'm sorry, I don't have exact turnaround time. And there's so many different testing programs, and depending on what who you're using for the testing, it can vary. Some of these are sent out of the area, and then then you have shipping time and all of that. So it's a pretty complicated situation.
But is it fair to say that this is somewhat of a nationwide issue as compared to, say, some European countries, that testing overall, it isn't necessarily completely coordinated statewide or nationally or in districts or counties?
You know, I can't speak for the nation, but I can say that at least in California, early on, the state set up a California testing task force. That is really, it's been a public-private partnership, and academic institutions are partnering in that. So we're looking at the whole system in terms of testing and monitoring what new tests are coming along with EUA authorization for use. And so As those new tests have come out, they've implemented and looked for opportunities to address capacity, putting these testing sites in communities across the state, whether they're at a pharmacy or they're in a building like we have at the BOG. So I think that there's definitely room for improvement. My understanding is that there's more home testing capacity that is expected to be coming. I don't know the timeline on that. And so I think it's an ever-evolving situation.
Thank you so much.
This is Daisy again with Channel 7. Just one quick question. Not sure if we, for our hospitals, not sure if we know what the youngest age group or person who you guys had to treat for COVID at your guys' hospital.
Do you mean admitting into the inpatient setting or just?
Yes, I'm so sorry. Yes.
I don't know that we can release that data. I think that is protected health information. We haven't from the county released that. I don't know if the hospitals have a different perspective on that.
Yeah, I would say very young. I just, you know, we've seen individuals, you know, in their young 20s at times, but I mean, I can't give specifics.
Would it be safe to say that people as young as maybe infants or children or so, I mean, can you give us a general ballpark of that? I'm not trying to push, I just want to make sure we, you know, we have some idea.
Jessica, I'm just drawn off memory of the data, and I can only think of a handful of what I call pediatric cases. I can't think of a case in a like a baby, somebody from birth to maybe like two. The majority of ours are more the 30 to 80 age group. We are seeing younger folks in this round, but we still have plenty of folks in their 70s, 80s, 60s.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you guys.
Any other questions?
Oh, sorry, just one more follow-up that I thought of. I know, Robert, you mentioned 64% of your hospital staff is vaccinated. Can I just get for like Shasta Regional, Shasta Health, Shasta Community Health, and Reading Rancheria really quickly? Thank you.
Yeah, we're 65-70% similar.
Yeah, we're in the 60s as well.
Today's numbers is 82% for Reading Rancheria's Tribal Health System.
Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? I'm not seeing any turned on microphones. All right. Thank you all for being here. We appreciate all of you contributing to the conversation, and we will see you again next week. Everyone stay safe and healthy.